Hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. This is the first webinar we are hosting in 2016, and my name is Yahya, and along with me, I have my few colleagues on this session for today. I have with me Mr. Sarup Govindan, who is our web consultant, who will be speaking about the designs of websites, the new technologies used to design websites. Along with him, I have Mr. Dipesh Banushali, who will be showing us and demonstrating a few tips and tricks on how you can easily manage your users for better efficiency and how you can recycle your licenses for better use of your existing licenses. We also have Mr. Jojo Varghese with us today. He will be the moderator for the day. And any questions would be asked to us by Jojo. If you have any questions during the session, you can simply put it down in the comment section of the YouTube video. And Jojo will be asking us the same questions, and we will be able to answer it. So today's presentation would start off by me. I would be talking about the DNS, importance of DNS, and how we should better maintain and manage your DNS services. So let's start with the session. I'm going to share my screen with you and show you a presentation which we have made for the DNS technologies. Let me share my screen. This is the presentation. Cool. So what is a DNS and why is DNS important for you? And why am I specifying the importance of DNS in today's webinar? Now, DNS is known as the domain name service or the domain name system. And it's the primary building block of any domain. So consider you have a domain called gulfinfotech.com, and you have an email service on any of the email services you have currently present, or you have a website, and usually a domain has both the emails and the website together. Now, who is the agent or who is the source who tells the internet traffic to point us to that particular website or that particular email service? That job is done by the domain name service, by the DNS, and that's the basis of DNS. So we can call it as a directory which guides the traffic of internet to its respective servers. So consider I am going to gulfinfotech.com, and I have this beautiful website on the internet for gulfinfotech.com, but then how does the internet know to point it to that specific website and not my test website or the beta version of that website? How does it know to specifically go to that specific website? Now, that job is done by the DNS, specifically by its A record pointed on the DNS of gulfinfotech.com as a domain. The same also works for an email service with the MX record. So whenever you send an email to probably yahya@gulfinfotech.com, my DNS tells me that my emails are going to be hosted on so-and-so server, so you need to send the email to that specific server and not to anyone else, so that I get the email and I can easily respond back to you. Again, that job is done by the DNS or the domain name service. So it is primary that you maintain your DNS as well as possible in the best ways possible. Now, the DNS, in short, it acts as a point of reference to anything and everything associated with your domain. So as I said, your website, your emails, if you have subdomains, if you have mapped your ERP system or anything with your domain name, and your DNS is down, it's not going to work. So basically, to have everything up and running, your DNS should be good and it should be maintained and taken care of. Now, what does everything boil down to? And sometimes we've seen in our careers in the past 8 years of me being into service as gulfinfotech, we've seen many cases wherein a domain is down, and people might think that their email service is down, because one day morning after the weekend, mostly that happens, the users, they come to work and they don't receive any emails. The first doubt goes as the emails are down. It's actually the emails are not down, the domain is down. And once we identify where the domain is hosted, who is the domain registrar, where to fix the records from, it's too late. And that's the reason you need to have a good record of who owns which domain, who is the domain registrar, who is the DNS provider, who has the credentials for all these things. It should be documented in a secure place. So a domain specifically has four parts into it. Now, the domain registrar is someone from where you buy the domain. So for example, gulfinfotech.com. From where do we buy this domain, gulfinfotech.com? Where did we buy this domain from when we had purchased it? It was from GoDaddy. So GoDaddy would act as our domain registrar. Now, it is not necessary that GoDaddy acts as our DNS provider. Our DNS provider can be a third party altogether. Consider our DNS provider is Amazon Web Services with their Route 53 technology, or Microsoft's DNS technology. And our domain registrar is GoDaddy. So in short, we pay for our domain renewals to GoDaddy. And whenever we want to change any MX records or A records, we need to go to the Amazon DNS service or Microsoft DNS service, for example, and change the records over there. We cannot go to GoDaddy and change the records because our DNS is no more on GoDaddy. It's on the third-party hosting. Now, sometimes your website and your domain name service is together. So what happens is you have your website hosting on a separate place, and some customers, they prefer having the DNS also along with the website hosting. So in such cases, your registrar and your DNS and web hosting is entirely different. So it creates a little confusion here and there sometimes. But then in some of the cases, your registrar, your DNS provider, and your website hosting can be the same entity. For example, GoDaddy, they sell everything. They sell you the domain. They also give you the DNS as well as give you website hosting. So you can have everything in the same console, everything in the same bucket. Coming on to email services, that's also something which works along with your domain name. So that works with your MX records, and that's what I had told you in the previous slide, that the MX records is crucial for your email services to run. Now, the website and the email services, they can be either on-premise or on cloud. The on-premise technologies are very rare these days. People don't like hosting the website on-premise because it is high maintenance. They usually go for the cloud because anyways, the website is a public entity. It should be open to everyone. And for us, the email service, cloud offers more security on your emails than the on-premise variant. On the cloud variant, we have Google Apps or Office 365, for example. So that's the basics of your DNS and the difference between the DNS and the registrar. So sometimes what happens is your domain goes down, your DNS goes down. We don't need to contact your domain registrar, but we need to contact your DNS provider where your DNS is actually hosted, because that's where we can fix your DNS records from. So that's the basics of a domain name and its records. Now, I would also like to brief you on the few important records which are available on the DNS. The first record which I would like to talk about is the A record. Now, the A record is mostly used for mapping websites to the domain name. So in the first example, I told you that if you type in gulfinfotech.com, it should go towards our primary website, the official website, and not to any other website. Who tells the internet traffic to point it to the official website of gulfinfotech? That is the A record. So that is the basics of an A record. So when you change your DNS and you have taken care of everything, but then you skip the A record or you miss it, your website would be down. But if you take care of your MX records and have it there, your emails would be working, but your website would be down. The second record is the MX record or the mail exchange records. Now, the mail exchange records or the MX records are used to route your emails towards your primary email server. This can be only one email server. So consider you want to have Google Apps and Office 365 together. That's not possible. You need to have either one as your primary email server because that's where your mail traffic is going to go to. Now, the MX records have a certain logic based on priority scale. Now, the priority scale differs from 0 to 100. It can be any number, even about 100, depends on the hosting or the DNS providers you choose. But then the lowest number is the highest priority. So consider your MX record is on zero, then the email traffic would go to that server which is on zero priority. So that's the importance of an MX record. It is critical to have correct MX records for proper email flow. Next, we come on to the TXT records. The TXT records are mostly used for verification process, verification progress on your cloud applications or any other application for that matter. It also is used sometimes for security protocols like the SPF, the DKIM, and the DMARC records. I will be speaking on the SPF, DKIM, and the DMARC records in a later webinar, and we'll be sending you out the invitations for that as well. The fourth kind of a record is a CNAME record. Now, the CNAME record is similar to the A record used for subdomains or rerouting addresses, but then it can only be pointed to a host name. It cannot be pointed to an IP address. The A record, on the other hand, can be pointed towards an IP address instead of a host name. So those are the important records on the DNS. Other than this, there are a few other records for different other processes, but these are not very important records. If you are using Office 365, there is another record called the SRV record, which is important for technologies like Skype for Business to be functional properly. So those are the important records on DNS. Now let's talk about what happens when a DNS is changed. So let me give you an example or a scenario over here. So consider you have your email services running on Office 365 and your website is running on probably GoDaddy, okay? And then suddenly you say that my website is not very good. You give a contract to somebody to develop your website, and the vendor, they say that we need to change your DNS so that the DNS and the website hosting is on the same console. So or for better usage or for better integration with your website. Now, when that happens, sometimes the people who change your DNS, they forget to add your MX records or the other important records which were there on your previous DNS. What does this cause? This causes a downtime. And this causes a downtime which people don't understand at first, but then on investigation, we come to know that this was due to negligence. Negligence of not putting the proper records in the proper place and doing it in the right way. So these are the few tips you need to take care of when you change your DNS records. So you need to first make a copy of your zone files from the previous DNS server and then prepare for moving it to the new DNS server. What is a zone file? A zone file is a set of records on your DNS. It includes your A record, your MX record, and whatever records are available on the DNS. The collective term for that is a zone file. So once you have a copy of your zone files, then you can start proceeding towards your new server. And then you change your name servers at the domain registrar level. You replicate the records on your new server, and then you switch to your new server. When this switch happens, usually there is a downtime of 2 to 4 hours, but again, it depends on your TTL. Now, the TTL is known as the time to live. Time to live is basically, again, let me give you an example. For example, I go to gulfinfotech.com right now from my computer. My computer would be caching gulfinfotech.com to a specific IP address which is there. And after some time, if I go back to gulfinfotech.com, my computer knows, my nearest DNS server knows that gulfinfotech.com can be reachable on this and this on so and so IP address. So it doesn't go back to my primary DNS and check what is the IP address. It just takes it from the cache. When does it go back and check again? It's when the TTL expires. So consider my TTL is for 1 hour and I go to gulfinfotech.com right now. My cache, the DNS cache for me, is going to tell me the address for gulfinfotech.com within the 1 hour. Once the 1 hour period expires, it will again go to my primary DNS and check where this gulfinfotech.com lies or which server does it have from. Now, once everything is good on your process, once the DNS has been changed, you need to check if your records have been propagated properly. Now, to do that, you have websites called the MX Toolbox. and a certain other DNS propagation website wherein you can go and type in your domain name and check if the propagations have been done correctly. Now, this is very crucial for your business to be up and running, because if a domain goes down, your email traffic goes down as well as your website goes down. And this is not acceptable by any business. So this needs to be taken care of very crucially. Now, how do you maintain your domain, or how do you upkeep your domain? So the first and basic strategy to having a healthy domain is to buy your domain from a well-known registrar. A well-known registrars, they range from GoDaddy, name.com, network solutions, and whatever. You can search for reviews online. We are not endorsing any domain registrar here. These are just examples of famous domain registrars globally. Another tip is to renew your domains, at least the important domains, for at least 5 years, minimum of 5 years, so that you can avoid any kind of disruption. Now, every domain has a few details, a few contact details, known as the administrative contact, the billing contact, the technical contact, and so on and so forth. Now, the administrative contact and your technical contacts need to be up to date. This is because if there is any scenario of a dispute of ownership for your domain, the ICANN authority, the authority for the domains, they're going to leverage on the contact information available on the DNS, on your administrative and technical contacts. If those are right, they would be contacting the person over there, and they will verify the ownership, and then they will award the ownership to that particular entity in case of a dispute. Now, this doesn't happen often, but it happens, and we need to be careful if the time it happens. The last and final point is maintain proper records and details for who has ownership of your domain or who's maintaining your domain. If you have scenarios wherein your domain registrar is different from your DNS provider, you need to have records of who is your domain registrar, who has your DNS, and if possible, also have the credentials for that. Now, you need to maintain that. So in case tomorrow there is an issue, you know whom to contact. Otherwise, sometimes what happens when an issue comes and we are looking out for help, we don't know where to go, and we are confused on who has the DNS and who will be able to help us. Now, that time wherein we waste while we are confused, it costs us a lot of downtime, because our email services, our websites, they are all down because the DNS is down. And we could have just saved on that time if we would have known who has the controls for the DNS and who is the domain registrar. So these things need to be kept in safe custody. It needs to be recorded properly that who has the information correctly. So on this slide, I'm just putting up links on the few important URLs which I had mentioned during the presentation. You can know more about what is a DNS through the GoDaddy's help article. The DNS analyzer, which I was talking about, MX Toolbox, you can go into that link. And to check if your DNS has been propagated, you can go to whatsmydns.net. Again, we are not endorsing any of these URLs, but because these URLs are available for free, and this is what we use mostly to do our checkings, so that's the reason we are just demonstrating it during this presentation. If you have any questions regarding this presentation or any of the topics which I've covered today, you may simply send us an email on connect@gulfinfotech.com. Now, don't go anywhere. We still have today's presentation left. Now, after me, we'll be joined by Mr. Sarup Govindan, who will be explaining about website designings, about flat and the legacy designs of logos and other technologies. So I'll hand over the presentation to Mr. Sarup. And let me stop my screen share. Sarup, the presentation is yours. Welcome.
Thank you, Ajna. Okay. Coming to my topic, which is web design trends to increase conversion. So it is important for business to have a website, is how people are likely to find you. So these days, most people will go online and research products and companies before they make any purchase. So if you don't have a website, you are missing out all of this potential business. So even if people don't buy your product online, they are still likely to research it online. So you have to have a website so these people can learn about your business. So considering the importance of website in online marketing, let's see some web design trends that will help us to generate online leads. So I'm going to share my screen now. Can you see my screen?
Yeah. Yes, the screen is visible.
Okay. So the first thing which we are going to discuss about the layout. Okay, so the first layout trend which we are usually seeing in nowadays is split screen layout. So just take a look at this image. See, as the name says, here homepage is split right into two. So this is good if you have more than one product or more than one service or overall category. And it's really good to split people right away as soon as you can and take them into whichever side of the website, most likely they convert. So it's not going to make them to convert right there, but you are taking them into the right spot with an objective to get a lead. Okay, the second type of layout is card design layout. So if you are talking about card design layout, the advantage of this kind of layout is it is very visual and it allows people quickly go to whatever interests them most. And this design is Pinterest inspired design. I mean, Pinterest has introduced this concept long time ago. And today the leading social media sites like Facebook, Twitter and Google Plus following this layout, and which is proven very effective in conversion. And the third layout which we need to consider is one page layout. As you know, the mobile device usage growth has influenced the way the websites are designed nowadays. So with smaller screens and supernatural touch scrolling movement, people prefer to scroll around instead of clicking on the links and waiting for the content to appear. So let's take an example of our friend Yahia's portfolio website. This is yahiasaki.com. So as you see, the pages have been replaced with sections and users can go to each section by scrolling down or clicking on top links. Actually, this technique works especially well for sites that want to attract users through storytelling, and you can still mimic a multi-page site by breaking the scroll into clear section like you see in this website. So moving on, we are going to the next topic, which is flat design. So flat design is a very popular and current trend right now, not only in web design, but design in general. The basic design fundamentals of flat design is color, typography, space, and simplification. In simple, this means getting rid of gradients, drop shadow, interglow, all those things. The flat design forces designers to focus more on content, pick the right colors to help users navigate through designs, and use white space with care. Now let's see some of the popular brand logos. As you see in this image, you can see that's Google's old logo and new logos. See, the new logos are much more simple, clean, and attractive. This recent changes shows flat design is future, and 68% of web designers are think that flat web design will still be around 5 years from now. And the next topic we are going to talk about is RWD. RWD means responsive web design. Responsive web design is becoming less of a trend and more of a best practice. So nowadays, modern mobile phones such as smartphones, tablets have taken the place of desktops. This means surfing the web with mobile devices increasing. So it is vital for your website to respond to all different sizes and resolutions. Studies have shown that 45 to 50% all-time online on smartphone and spending an average of 2 hours per day. And 30% of the online commerce taking place through mobile phones. And these figures are increasing day by day. So with these figures, it's safe to say responsive design is going anywhere soon. So if any of your business website is not mobile friendly, I suggest you to make it responsive as soon as possible. And the next topic which we are going to consider about increasing conversion is images. The using images on website is common, but current trend is on full width images. As you see on these images, Google is using a full width banner on his homepage. People use images to engage more with users and illustrate the message they are trying to send. For a long time, the web has been suffering from taking fake-looking stock photography with super happy people wearing perfect smile and suits. But the studies have shown that people generally ignore those kind of photos. However, 2016 is the year of genuine imagery, and we should take advantage of using real photos to connect with your audience in a genuine way. And the next one which we are going to consider is Cinemagraph, which is Cinemagraph is basically a still image in which one element of the image is moving. So Cinemagraph in website is getting popular as it giving life to images. So these two points are related with images, and next we are going to consider about videos. So websites generally are storytelling tools, and storytelling can be more effective when visuals and motions come into picture. So we have seen business implementing videos in their websites as background videos, customer testimonials, or product demos. So in 2016, this trend will grow even more with the endless possibilities of 3D graphics and HD quality videos to build the impression of real life experience. Next important thing is monochromatic color with CTA. So it is easy to figure out if you go the website with banner images black and white or any kind of monochromatic style. Monochromatic style means the color scheme is based on variation of one particular color. Then you have a CTA button with bright color, of course it will get attention plus extra click because it is much more visible. As you see in this image, this get started but now button is very much visible. So based on the popularity of usage of CTA, we can choose two methods. One is sticky CTA. First, it is very key whenever you have your CTA, you always want to be visible it all the time. So usually we keep it up in the header like a sticky header, as you see in gulfinfotech.com. That will always remain on the top or sticky sidebar. And the another usage is single column CTA. Same like as you seeing in our website, if website is has multiple columns, studies have shown that if you interrupt the flow when people scroll down with a headline and CTA button with plenty of white space around it, people will stop and take notice and definitely going to be more inclined to click. So the next topic we are going to cover is navigation. So here I would like to consider two kind of navigation. One is simple navigation. So giving too many options, people likely to choose nothing at all. So in fact, study shows that given too many options, people actually 10 times less chance to convert. This is why most of the websites are using only limited links on top navigation and hide the rest behind the hidden menu icon. And it is commonly seen that highlight one menu on navigation as a call to action button. And this is how we prioritize navigation for lead capture. So if you see in this image, you can see only mainly they are showing only four links and one link is using as a call to action, which is buy now button. And the second kind of navigation is sticky navigation. Sticky navigation in simple words, it is always visible. The idea is very efficient to navigate users to inner pages at any point of time without scrolling up or down. You can see the same effect in our website, which is gulfinfotech.com. If you scroll down or scroll up, the top part will remain same and it will be fixed on top. That is what sticky navigation. And coming to my last point, which is personalized UX. UX means user experience. So personalization is giving the users what they want without them having to ask for it. So the depth of personalization varies, but everyday example includes related content, recommendations, and push notification for events like birthday. Think a site like Amazon or LinkedIn. See, whenever you go to Amazon, they know you looked at last time and people are not going to purchase at the first time. But you, if you are returning visitor, they will always show you the last couple of items you looked at. This is very personal. they knew your browsing habit, they knew you have seen, and by showing them again, they're taking a chance much closer to making that sale. It's the same case with LinkedIn also. If you go to LinkedIn, you can also see that people you may know, they are suggesting people you may know, and you can connect with those people. This is all comes under personalized user experience. So with this, I am winding up my session and moving on. I'm handing over this session to Dipesh. He's going to talk about how to manage users.
Thank you, Saurabh, for handing over the session to me. And here I am, Dipesh Bhanushali, the technical consultant of Gulf Infotech. Usually you have heard my name over the phone only, but this is the first time I'm on live, on air. So thank you, Yaya, thank you, Jojo, thank you, Saurabh, to celebrate this webinar here. So today, like my colleague Yahya and Saurabh has covered a major part, which is like when we talk about a company, the company is, they have the domain, they have the website, and they have the email. So initially we started the same way, like first we talk about the website domain, DNS, then we talk about the websites, and now we are talking about the email. Email are generally for the user base we are the company holding. So when we say about the company, there are in and outs, like this, many users are going, many employees are going to be joined, and many maybe go. So the today's topic, my topic is mainly considering like the, what to do when the employee is going to leave the organization, or they are on the notice period and they're supposed to be go in soon or somewhere like in a particular time being. So in that time, the admin as an IT representative, we should have some of the responsibility or some of the tasks to be achieved within that small number of time to avoid any knowingly deleted data or any mistakenly deleted data. So we should be aware about that thing. So to do that, initially I'm going to share my screen. I will show you the slideshow. Okay, so very first, the topic of the concept is five things should do when the employee is going to be leave the organization, or the employee is going to be on a notice period. So very first is like the collect the data belongs to the account. Is like the, we know like when we talk about the any of the email accounts, say example if it is a Google or if it is an Office 365 or any of, today we are in the world, there is a collaboration, like the not only email account we are getting, but much more we are going to be have there with our account, email, contact, calendar. And if we talk about specifically for the Google also offer the Google Analytics, Google AdWords, Google AdSense, which this both topic, the AdWords, analytics and the AdSense, this all three are the related to the topic which was covered by Saru. So might be the one of the person who we are targeting here might be leaving the organization was managing all these accounts. One more is the YouTube, just like we are doing the Hangout on air. So this is going to be a relate to one of the account of our Gulf Infotech. The same way, there are also many tasks like that person what for whom we are talking about might be have the intranet website. So before, whenever the person is going to be leave the organization, just understand that while working with the company, what type of responsibility he had and he has served that with using the same account. So the very like the what we are going to be covered, like there are 5 points, but it doesn't make any sure like you should go with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but you can go according to the situation or the area where you are in. So this is the one key point you should be considered before thinking about to delete the user. Second thing is like the whenever the customer, like most of the time we know like the whenever employee is going to leave, he will be served the notice period. So at that time when the IT come to know, the IT person or the person come to know about the activities, like the person is in notice period, what we can do for the safety side, make sure like the that user has an additional destination of the data. Okay, in the term of email, we can put additional destination for the whatever emails are coming in or going out for the particular user should be get delivered to the one core area. Okay, and what about the other data? Say example, if we have a few products for the Google apps, which is like Google Vault and spanning backup. The both of the service provide the same objective, like they archive the data. So why I am covering here is like if say all organizations do not offer a spanning backup or Google Vault for each and every users, but at the same time when they are going to leave or the user is most important, you can assign the license specifically for them. So with this you are going to secure the data what they already have. So it's say example like we have seen the, if some unknown way if the employee is going to leave or he is going to be go out without proper serving the notice or he just try to delete all the data, still it's sure like IT can go and can restore the data at any point of time. So this is the most important, like to configure the additional destination of the data where you can go next time and you can collect the data according to the need. Here is the third point I wish to involve is like it's like whenever the say example we have seen the customers like they are just considering about the password. Okay, whenever the employee is going to leave the organization, they just change the password. But no, this is not only the way, like you are going to revoke the all access. Apart from the password, nowadays, as I said, like in the beginning, it's a collaborative. Like each and every product has the much more other products involved in that. So only changing the password is not going to fail, but it's an initial stage you should take. So here I have mentioned like change the password or the first point. Okay. Second is like each and every we know like while doing the login or some of the website offers like to keep your session for this computer. This is your private computer or the public. Or you want to keep remember you. So this is all marked like in at the back end, whatever the license or sign in cookies are going to be happen while doing the sign in, they will be stored in your cache. So until like even if the password has changed, might be the possibly you are not going to be the user is not going to be asked for to enter the new password for a particular session. So why we should take that chance and just straight away click on the link where you can reset the session or the cookies for the user. So one account, say example, if I talk about the Google, okay, Google Apps account, we have the Google Apps sync tool, we have the many migration tools. So they all tools are going to be configured as API based. They are not going to be, they only need a username and password at the time of confirmation. Once you are confirmed, they don't require your username and password once again. They are going to be work anyway, even if the password has changed. So in that case, we really appreciate if admin can have once the here we are talking about the situation where user employee is already gone. So now this account is going to be managed by the IT admin. So here admin can take a control of the account, okay, and do this task from two ways, either to login from the end user, either from the admin console. Okay, I have given all the links here with the slide presentation. Okay, when once we finish the webinar, we will mention this slideshow link at the bottom of your description where you can refer it. So from Google Apps console, you can go to the user, you can revoke the API based access. Okay, if the person has utilized just two-step verification, you can remove those two-step verification activities, like say example the authorized mobile or the application specific password or any of the other connectivities. Now the one more thing is like the each and every user is going to be used the same account for the mobile device. It's a better like once you confirm like the user is leave the organization, now you, admin can take control, go to the settings, go to the mobile device management and remove the account. There are two options. The one is the wipe the account and one is the wipe the mobile device. So when you wipe the mobile device, the whatever data is there for the mobile, it might be that an employee's personal data that is also be going to be a wipe. So we suggest to only do a wipe the account, which is belongs to the organization, not to the personal. So here, the concluding the slide is like the one major things to be understand is resetting the password is not going to be solve the matter in some cases. Also try to have a look, give some time and go to the same areas where this all settings going to be happen. If you found, it's better to revoke. So the last option is like what to do once you all done this, like you still have here the when we talk about the user, we have consumed our license there. Okay, now the employee is going to be leave the organization. So what to do? What to do with the data? There are two concepts. The one is take the data as a backup archive. Second is utilize it again. Say example, like if I want to take a backup of the offline backup, right now like each and every account is on cloud, like the Google account, Office 365, everything is on cloud. So the reason of taking backup is like you can take the backup offline and you can utilize that license again for the new person who is going to replace that. So in that way you have a multiple choice here according to the situation. Let me talk about that. Is like the Google takeout. Most of you guys may know the Google takeout is the very free features offered by Google apps as well as the Gmail, the consumer version. Each and every Google user can go to the console, they can search for the Google takeout, the link I have given here, and they can create an archive with the set of all the services which is clubbed with the account. With that, say example, we are talking about the drive data. Say if you have a spreadsheet, Google spreadsheet, Google Doc, they are going to be converted in the native form of the MS Office. The spreadsheet will go to the Excel or document go to the Docs and slides will go to the PowerPoint the same way. And second option available is the Microsoft Outlook sync tool for the Microsoft Outlook. In that, what you can do, like the same way we just have to configure our Outlook, okay? So we have contact, calendar and the mails data in the PST format. Generally, when we talk about the takeout of any of the applications, any of the archive solution provided by Google or the spanning, they will give us a data in Ambox format. So this is a bit different. It's open source format, okay, and it has a less convenient compared to the PST. So PST is owned by Microsoft, okay, and the Outlook is the best application to run the PST. So that's why whenever we talk about this section, we suggest to sync the account in the Outlook completely. Okay, once all data is downloaded, now you can take that PST as an offline archive and you can utilize at any time, any point of time. The same way you can do with the Google Apps for Vault, Google Apps Vault. Okay, you can export it and same you can do the spanning backup. So spanning backup, Vault and takeout is going to be give you an Ambox format and the Google Apps sync tool for the Outlook is going to be give you the PST. Okay, this is all about like the doing the export in the offline mode. Like here you are taking a data from the Google server to your local computer. But what if you want to reuse? If you want to reuse for the another user in the same organization or the person may be needed in the future. So the same way we have the tool, okay, the Google Apps migration tool for the Microsoft Outlook. This is whenever you download a sync tool, by default this tool is going to be installed. Okay, and now you can go to the menu bar and you can choose this option. This option is very useful to upload the PST what you have downloaded or what you have collected from the tool sync tool. Okay, now you can upload the same PST on the another user account. It's an end user tool, like admin doesn't require anything to do here. Okay, but admin also has the one more migration tool, but that will be the migration activity and that's why I am not involved here. So the best is like Google migration tool for the Outlook. So end user, individual user can do and admin doesn't have need to be wait there to complete that activity. It is going to be on their own way and then you can close it straight away. Second is the Google Drive data transfer. This is going to be done from the admin console only. Say example like the user was very friendly with the all Google product and he was using the web interface while he was managing so many projects on the web. And there was so many data with that. So simply we cannot go and delete all the data. Okay, and even if I download this, there are so many sharing permissions, there are so many, the people was depend on that for sharing folder. So we cannot make it offline and just delete the data. Data should be there always. Even it doesn't make any difference if the user is there or no. It should be that way. So instead of doing the taking the offline data, what you can do, simply go to the admin console, drive, and from there you can take a destination source and the destination. The person we are talking about going to be leave organization is the source for us. So now here what we will do, we will take a data from the source and going to be transfer the ownership of that data to the destination. So the whatever that is shared or the owned by the source account is going to be owned by the destination. All the sharing rights will be the same and intact. The major difference is going to be happen here is like the whatever data, say example there was a 2 GB of data used by the source. Now this 2 GB is going to be consumed by the destination. Okay, the whatever ownership had by the source account is going to be transferred to the destination account, and the source account is going to be a part of the editor's. Then he will lose the ownership and he will become an editor of that document. Now you are free to delete that account if you don't require them anymore. Third thing is, like, if we are talking about the mail, and if you do not found it like useful or the easy to do a migration task using the migration tool, simply, like, we have in our life, if we are talking about IT, definitely we have configured the Outlook Gmail account in Outlook. It's a pop, like, it's a username and password. Okay, pop.gmail.com, and that's it. Some of the port 995, the port number need a secure. So it's just a very simple. The same, if I ask you, instead of the configuring the same account in the Outlook, just configure in the another Gmail account. See, I will give you, might be you are not aware about this feature, but this is a very vast and very useful feature provided by the Google for each and every person. It is also available in the Google apps as well as the Gmail consumer version. So you can go to the Gmail setting, there you will find the add another pop account you own. With this, you can add another Gmail account too, as well as the Outlook account, the whatever the account you already have, and they are available accessing over the pop. So you can add them, and the whatever data you have there is going to be copied out here on your another account. So it's a term of, you can say, the transfer of the data from one to another, and you will have the one more copy of the data. So now you can worry off of your actual data and the source. The same can be done with the additional third-party tool, which is called Spanning Backup. In that, the whatever the archive is there for the user, we are talking about the target, which is going to be leave the organization, and you can do the cross restoration to the team leader or the person who is going to replace him, or the person or the CEO or the director, whatever the in charge, the superior of that person, you can transfer it. So this is the way you can do the export or either the transfer of the data. Okay, so here, while concluding, I'll tell you, like, the whenever the user is going to be leave the organization, once he is out and now you are in charge of the account, don't delete it straight away. At least you, even if you don't require the data, take the offline, okay, and then delete it. Because we have seen the cases where customers are ask us to delete the account, and after just a 10 days they are coming back and asking us to provide the data. But unfortunately, Google do not provide a data back within after the 5 days. If we delete the user, we do not have any chance to restore it after the 5 days. Even Google do not have that data with them. So that's why before deleting the user, think twice and act once. That's so here we are going to be on our last and final slide, where I always suggest, like, say example, if we are talking here, we are talking about the organization, the business. Okay, when we had a need of them, that's why we are appointing that. So, and whenever the person is going to be resigned, sooner or later the someone is going to be replacing. So when the person is not on the place, or the company has not appointed, it doesn't mean like the no one is going to be fill that space. Definitely someone will, maybe not, but most of the cases we have seen, the person is going to be someone is going to be appointed very soon. So in the meantime, we always suggest don't be in a hurry in saving the license and all. Okay, wait for some time. Okay, and if someone is coming to be joined the same duty or the same role, straight away go and rename the user instead of just deleting. Deleting the user may give you a many. You have to go with our slide 1, 2, 3, 4, all that we have discussed before. But if you go straight away, go and rename the user. It's better always to take a backup of the data before assigning to someone else, but still you are in a less inner trouble. Like, you don't have to do all this exercise, and fewer exercise will be more than enough in this situation. So straight away rename the user. Second is reset the password. Like, while assigning the one account to the another, it's a better, you should go with the one by one. We have seen the cases, like, whenever the user is going to be renamed, the person who is going to replace him facing so many issues. They say, like, we are still getting contacted by the old person, and some of the other cases our display name is not getting corrected. So this is the one of the reason, that's why I have added that particular section dedicated to this only. So whenever you are renamed the user, always reset with the temporary password. As the employee, their own has the privacy and he's working for the company. He should know that he is the only one should know the password. Even we should not suggest to IT to keep the password with them if it's not necessary or it's not in a policy. So define the temporary password first. Let the user log in on the web interface first. Let them reset the password according to their need. Okay, now here we have the choice. Even whenever we are changing the username, what will happen if someone sending an email to old account? It's better to keep that address as an alias. Say example, like earlier there was a Dipesh@gulfinproduct.com, the person who was managing. Now Dipesh is going to be replaced by Yahya. So Yahya is going to be in a primary email address. But even if the person, the party, other XYZ person, they don't know the Yahya is the in charge, but still they are sending email to Dipesh. Okay, at that condition, we should be defined the alias of the Dipesh to Yahya. So even if someone send an email to Dipesh, it should be managed by Yahya. And Yahya can reply to that mails with whatever the next stage is there or the, whatever the suggested by the seniors are on. So this is. Second is like update. Like each and Google has a Google Plus profile, and each and every one of us are really using the Google Plus page and profiles and sharing them and elaborating the network. So here we suggest like whenever the user is there, they definitely use a Google Plus profile. So it's better to change the profile. Earlier there was a Dipesh who managed that Dipesh Balushali as a display name for the account. And one thing you should consider as IT, like the display name is going to be overtaken by the Google Plus profile. The whatever display name has been defined by the IT, okay, Yahya Zakir, it will be on a side if the Google Plus profile is going to be work with the Dipesh Balushali. So it's a better end user, and this is only going to be happen. It's only going to be allowed end user to go and edit their profile. So ask user to do a login, then go to the Google Plus page, then edit the display name or all other details which belongs to the user, the new user. There is a one more option is like recovery options. Say example, like we are aware of the many places we are putting, like what was your birthplace, what was your date, what was your mother's middle name, or some more questions. The same way in the Google, we have the recovery option as your mobile number, okay, as your secondary email address. So this is the most critical area where someone can access your account if he has, or maybe he do not know the password, but he can try to log in using this recovery option. So it's always better to define the recovery options, and always better whenever you are assigning a one account to another, always ask him to change the recovery options. So this is all, and with this I'm going to finish what we have discussed. As I said, like after the webinar, we are going to share our slideshows with you, and you guys can enjoy the all other details. And if you have any doubt, you can reach us. Okay, and here I am. I am done. So thank you so much for your time, and appreciate your presence.
Thank you, Dipesh. Thank you, Sarup. Now, if you have any questions, you can put it in the comment section under the video, and then Jojo will be able to read it out for us, and then we'll be able to answer it for you. If you want to ask us questions at a later stage, you can simply send us an email on connect@gulfinfotech.com. That's connect@gulfinfotech.com. Jojo, are there any questions awaiting us?
Currently there are no questions as such. I think we'll be mailing the questions once they get back.
Perfect. So great. So thank you for joining us in the session. And if you have any questions at any time, simply send us an email on connect@gulfinfotech.com, and we'll be able to help you out on that. Thank you for joining us, and see you in the next video. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.